behalf of Joseph, Carl, Stu, and myself, we'd like to welcome everybody to the Zoom this evening. I will start out with saying that we are going to be a little bit light because of all the train shows in town, which is something that we just can't prevent. You know, train shows are going to happen. So things are going to be a little bit light this evening. The topic for tonight was operating cars, since we covered operating accessories last year. But if you have an operating accessory, we'll take that into consideration also, just in the spirit of the evening. And then we'll open it up for free forum. So I have one item to share myself. I know I have a couple pictures from Clem in the queue, and I don't know if anybody else has anything to share this evening on operating cars. Joseph.
I got half a dozen.
Okay, well, let's go with Joseph first, and then Carl, I got you in the queue for second. Go ahead, Joseph.
All right, 3462 from 1948 or so. And as you can see, back in the 1970s, my hobby consisted of finding beat up post-war cars at train shows and then sprucing them up with road names that Lionel never manufactured. So this is a refrigerated car of the Gulf Mobile and Ohio Railroad. And it's been repurposed. Of course, it no longer delivers milk. What do you suppose is inside these doors, Clem? Delivering a
COVID
supply of fresh vaccines.
Yeah.
Of course, those of us who were old enough to have played with these in the post-war era, in mind for flu and COVID and RSV and pneumonia and whatever else they think of, get them all. So this reefer will bring the vaccines to you. I will say that that dose is a little big for the poor guy who has to ride inside the car. And I haven't tested it yet to see if he will expel it by remote control. But the full-scale version that came out in 1955 or so is about a half inch taller. And so these little bottles might fit better in that version. But that's my operating car for tonight.
All right. Well, thank you, Joseph. Got anything else, or that's it for the night?
That's all I brought.
All right. Thank you. And Carl, I think you're all queued up and ready to go. So let me get you on the spotlight and go ahead.
Okay. I'm going to switch cameras here. There we go. So the first thing I have is, I decided an operating car is a car that does something when you push it down the track. And turn that around. There we go. Mm-hmm. So this is from a Kinder egg, Kinder Surprise. Kinder Surprise, a chocolate egg. Comes inside the chocolate egg is this capsule. And then folded up in the capsule is a prize. And sometimes they're trains, which, you know, of course, I'm thrilled by that. And this one has a little guy, and Ooh. It comes in variations. Some have one man, some have two, and then some have different colors. So that's from Kinder Egg. And then I think this is a Sanya passenger car. Let me get the lighting angle a little better here. So this one's operating because when it rolls down the track, little flagman on the back waves the flag, That's for basically about S gauge track. Came with a battery powered locomotive. I've got a tanker and a gondola and a tender and the locomotive. Came with that set. So that's kind of fun. Now, moving on to Lionel. Here's the Erie Express. And that's an operating car. Because when you turn the right wheels, the side panel changes.
Wow.
See Beware and Spooky Eyes. The tender. Turned the right way here. Tender when it rolls down the track. Wrong one, I guess. There it goes. The coal load lifts up and you see the goons. The passenger car. When it rolls down the track, the windows move like the there we go.
Holy fun.
Like the fish car. And these are all, they all have the Lionel symbol on them. Yeah, not getting the great focus on that, but.
Were they actually made by Lionel or is that licensed?
I'm sure that's licensed. They're, I think they're McDonald's. Let's see, it says licensed by Lionel. Made in China, toy 3/4. I think these were McDonald's. And then this one wasn't working very well, but I decided to figure out how it worked. So I broke the case open. Come on, open up again. You can do it. It's actually glued together, so I had to pry pretty hard to get it open. There we go.
It goes.
So down here, this wheel runs a gearbox. And there's little gears in here. And then the top, the last gear, runs a cam. It's working in that little slot right there. And then that slides it back and forth. And this disc will roll back and forth and show out the side. I mean... Yeah, you know what's a Happy Meal? $3-4, and they made all this just for a toy to put in the Happy Meal.
Mm.
Okay, so that's, you know, you can see it moving a little bit there. Okay, now we're gonna move over to the layout. Okay, we got Christmas train here. We got the elves work back and forth. Now we got Santa and the reindeer hopping along. And then there's the probably a little scene, Firefly distillery car with flashing fireflies. That was the collector's car from the Toy Train Operating Society convention in 2011.
Mm.
And then, of course, the mermaid transport car with the mermaids swimming back and forth. And to finish it off, that's running. Rotating spotlight car. So that's what I have for today. Oh, I had one more thing I wanted to show you related to what we were talking about earlier. There's the radius gauge that I made up when I was bending my Gargoyle's track. The outside edges are that's the board I cut for the layout. And then these are the center lines for the inside curve and the outside curve is R48 and R52.
Mm.
Okay, back to you, Chris.
All right. Thank you, Carl. Appreciate that. Anybody have any questions for Carl before we move on? Well, okay. Let's see. Does anybody have anything else? We got a small crew tonight, so I don't know if anybody else or anyone has anything else. I've got Clem's in the queue, but it's going to be a little bit difficult. Clem, your video is we're going from Apple to Android to Microsoft, so it's the video is a little bit blurry. Let's put it that way. But I do have the pictures.
Yes. How nice is that? That's a little transformer with a bird bath and a flag. That was made by Carl Rimlin. Isn't that beautiful? See where the track wire comes in. All it does is lights and doesn't light. I guess it has power to somewhere. Carl gave it to me, and I think of him well. These are the two number 45 stations. The one on the left with the red door is Lionel, circa 1937. The one on the right is Russian, circa 1957. And their writing states that they invented that thing in 57. You'll notice the Russian one has no crossbucks because Russia ain't got no tossbucks. But they were not smart enough once they decided no crossbucks to center the station. So the whole thing looks dumb. It acts just as dumb. The guy inside has a black uniform on, very stern looking. The other guy's good old Shaq Louie, who's just looking like a regular American having fun.
Clem's, what's the material on the Russian?
Metal.
Sheet metal?
Sheet metal. I have to guess, I think the Russian station sign, the sign says Mofakba, and that's kind of like a beaver board or a thick fake board or something. It wasn't paper, it wasn't metal, so they had the capability then. I thought it'd be fun to see the two together. Oh, and Gateman's lantern is green on that car, on that one, and on the Lionel one it's red. So if that means anything to you.
Yeah. Now Hafner made one too.
Pardon?
Hafner made a 145 gate shack.
Did that? How does that compare?
Yeah, I'll run get it.
I know it.
Hey, Clem, does the Russian one work? Have you used it?
I don't think so. I used split pins for finishing the Russian, to enter the Russian thing, but I don't think I ever put power to it. You got me there. You got me. I will check on it.
All right. It'd be fun to find that out. Yeah.
Yeah. Probably speaks Russian. The station that went with the Russian set has a diesel horn sound in the station because it didn't fit in the engine. And it's worse than the GG1 sound. There's one of my favorites. I'm thinking about operating, etc. That's a 1923 or 24 Bauer. Bauer circular, they've got funny names, circular tower or something. Anyway, a little car is, where is he? Anybody see the car? Yeah, right about there.
Ah, yeah. See
you. You put him in the elevator and you take him up to the top and you give him a little goose and he heads off down the track. At 0.007 miles per day, with two little kids in them that I added. And if you're lucky at the very bottom, it gets ends in the elevator ready to go up again. Now, I have a question. I used the stuff we've used for years. What's it called? Never dull? The Army used it for polishing all their brass. So I got a nice shine on the track. But if I go out there right now and rub it with my hands, I get a black mark off the track. So whatever's in that chemical is either helping me or not. But after several days, I'll get it to where it will go down the hill by itself. If I could just read what I was supposed to do. Anyway, enjoy.
Is that an electric elevator on that or a manual?
Manual.
Okay.
It comes up on the roller. Has a little trip to give the car a little goose, and off we go. When I got it, Nasty Frank had it out of Baltimore, and it was beat. I soldered 3/4 of the things, and somebody said, repaint it. Well, no. You want to see the original paint on that one. Somewhere I have the paperwork on that, if somebody cares. I just can't imagine trying to eat Christmas dinner if you've just been given that thing just before dinner. You ain't going to dinner. You're going to be right there playing that thing.
Joseph, you got your hand up. Go ahead.
This is about the pre-war Gateman. There's a little bit of a mystery. The Gateman, the Lionel version of the Gateman, is blue. He's two pieces. He's made of Bakelite. And the flag that he's waving is a celluloid, real thin piece that's caught between his two halves. And the mystery is this. We think that the Bakelite pieces were actually molded in blue. They're not painted. And one collector who's cut one open tells me that he's blue clear through to his middle.
Wow.
But at least one example is brown on the outside and blue in the middle. Something like a cookie that was left in the oven too long.
Are they?
Now, we're used to seeing Bakelite being shiny black. They included carbon in the molding compound so that it would be black. And of course, transformers and things like that are usually black. Sometimes they got other colors marbled in. But it is possible to mold Bakelite in all the colors of the rainbow. They used to make jewelry of Bakelite, green, red, yellow, you name it. Lionel made the little merchandise boxes for the merchandise car in at least red and brown. The buttons on the uncoupler, unloader control are red. Those are Bakelite. But Leo Bakeland himself was very frustrated trying to keep up with the competition on the colors. So eventually he gave up the business. But anyway, the mystery is how did the gate man get a brown coat on a blue body? Back to Chris.
Don't have any idea.
Search. I see Carl waving a Gateman.
All right. Well, let's go back to Carl.
Okay. Let's see. There's one Gateman. This one's a little bit better shape. And It's got a little man. It looks like he's in a black body with blue painted uniform. And then this one's a really good one. Door's kind of falling off, but and he looks. He looks pretty much like a black body. Let's see, he's got more prominent buttons on his uniform than the other guy. Yeah, this guy's got a much smoother suit jacket on. And then, as I promised, there's the Hafner, more lithographed.
Nice.
And nobody's home.
Is that plastic?
No, this is all metal. You reach up underneath and do the solenoid thing. It's got a stop sign on the side, dust on the roof.
He jumped on the 505 going west.
Yeah.
Mm.
And it was inspected by Mr. HW. Oh, there's Clem's lift.
There's the lift. The little wagon and the two people are waiting for somebody to get to work.
We are going to try it again to do this little fellow.
Oh, it's moving.
That'd be me pulling it up, and I'm holding the camera, so it's going to be a dive bomb here in a minute while I get organized. It just comes and stands between those four pillars, and off he goes.
And off he goes, and off he goes.
Well, it was not calling for my skills. So there he goes.
Off he goes.
And then I don't think he's going to make it.
Oh, ran out of steam.
No.
A little graphite.
Well, I'm going to.
Sorry, Carl. I had to do it while I got it going.
Yeah, no, that's fine. That's fine. I was done.
You want me to get my Russian station so we see what the person looks like?
Sure, if you want to do that.
Sure.
I was surprised at the Russian locomotives. I think they were die-cast, weren't they? Like
yes.
Dorfin?
Yes. Heavy whatnot. Love them. I'll be back.
All right. Well, while you're doing that, I'll go back to operating cars if I can reach it over here. It's okay. Sitting off camera on my printer. But I wish the flyer guys were here tonight. Let me try to do this. I've got to do what Mama doesn't like. All right, I got to kill the background so you guys get to see the background. There you go.
You're not on the edge of the Grand Canyon?
No, I'm not really on the edge of the Grand Canyon. So this is American Flyer. This is the prize of my American Flyer collection. And let's try to do this, holding it up. This is the very hard to find. And it's still got the auction stickers in it, see? Where I picked it up. But this is the flyer version of the exploding boxcar. The two sides. Yep, I just dropped the roof. There went the retail value. But it is the actual, and I have tried numerous times to put this thing together. Unlike the Lionel one, the end box car frames go apart. So you've got the entire box car comes completely apart when hit by the missile or whatever.
Chris, can you spotlight yourself to make it big?
Oh, sorry about that. Let me try to do that. There we go. I should have done that earlier, Joseph. I'm sorry. So we have the button and the track trip for it.
Hey, Chris, that's an S-gauge.
That's S-gauge. There's the operating mechanism. The spring, let's see if I can do this. The spring actually comes around and gets held underneath. If you can see this, I'll try to do it on camera. Gets held underneath by the solenoid. So when the solenoid trips, and I try to do this without smacking my fingers, when the solenoid trips, it comes down. And then all these glorious pieces come flying off the boxcar. So you got the two ends, the two sides, the roof, everything comes flying off. I dearly wish there was a flyer person here tonight because they could do a lot better job describing what this car could do. But it's a wonderful, wonderful car. And to show you how crazy this hobby is, let me get rid of this thing here. To show you how crazy this hobby is, this car walked in the door of a Desert Division meet as a donation. It's roughly a $600 to $800 car. And the gentleman walked in, saw our website, and decided that he wanted to donate to Desert Division. And he had all this American Flyer stuff. And we took the, like I said, there you saw the auction sticker. It didn't get short-stopped. It did go into an auction. And I was the lucky bidder on it at the auction. But it's probably the key piece to my, that's why I got to blur the background. You can see what happens with the Grand Canyons there. I dearly wish there would have been somebody from some of our flyer guys on there this evening. It's a beautiful piece. I've had it on the layout one time. It actually stays intact, unlike the Lionel exploding boxcar that has a tendency of falling apart just running around on the layout. But that version compared to the Lionel version, I did have a couple other cars. I was hoping some of our Marks guys would be on here. The Marks Bill car is another one of my favorite cars for the for operating. That one is very clever because of the way the mechanism works. It's a mechanical mechanism, if you know Marks. There's a platform, and I'm kind of stalling here waiting for Clem to get back on camera. I think he's looks like he's having dinner right now. He's wandering around the kitchen. I can see him in the background. But the Marks car has a mechanical trip on it. So if the train or the boxcar or the reefer goes through the sidings backwards, the mechanism just pulls in. And if it goes through the platform the correct way, it actually operates and the little guy comes out of the milk car. He doesn't throw out a milk can, but he does pop out of the door. So for a Marks accessory, that's a pretty interesting accessory for an operating car. And of course, you know, all the spotlight cars like Carl showed. Clem, looks like you're getting ready to come back on camera. Are you ready for us?
I'm here. Have you guys seen, in your question now, you've seen the K-line car with a ping pong ball and the air compressor? Seen that thing?
Oh, yeah.
I've seen one in our life. Anybody got one of those?
I thought you showed a video of it one time, Clem.
Not me.
No. Okay. That's pretty cool. You go around the layout, and as long as you don't have a tunnel, it holds the ball up.
That was me, Carl.
Okay.
Yes.
I'm not down by the layout. The train's actually on the track,
there's my red door. It's cast. The cross bucks are cast, and Charlie's in here somewhere. There he is. And the light is in the floor, and the color of the light is in the floor. So he just waves his red lantern over the red light, and we're all supposed to be safe. And you'll notice there is a chimney. It comes with and without the chimney. And the dust.
Well, you're going to need to lift it up just a little bit more. It's not on camera. There you go.
There you go.
There he is. And his power connections are on the back. And he has two holes, one catty corner. Let me see if I get it. There's one of the holes. And that's to tie the thing down. Otherwise, he runs off. And then the Russians. Let me see if I can answer this. Sorry. Here's the Russian. In color, I want you to look at the green. And the American is over here in green. It is a different green. And what I see on the television is not what I see together. So there's some kind of different green.
Yeah, very similar chimney.
Pardon? The chimney
is... Chimney's the same design as the Lionel.
The same design as Lionel. So they, yeah, they had... Come on. Come with me. There they are.
Yeah.
Had the same design. And how about Ruski Dusky? Hold on. He's busy. There he is. What color is that?
Oh, black. He's got a belt on.
Yeah, he's got his belt on. Yeah. And two little screws in the middle out there where the crossbuck used to be. There's in the crossbuck version, there's one rivet. And this one here has got two rivets right there. And I don't know what the hell's inside. But there he is in at duty. Invented 20 years ahead of behind Lionel, but he's get credit. And he says in Cyrillic, Mofaka, right there in the woodshed. Whereas Lionel doesn't have a name on the woodshed. Neat, huh?
Hey, Clem, have you ever thought about taking just some still photos of that and putting them onto the TTML?
I have not thought of that. With it operating slowly, quickly?
Well, you don't need to have it operating. Just one picture of the gate man with the door closed, and then manually hold him open or electrically hold him open, and take another picture.
I can do
with
that
with the gate man, you know, fully exposed, so we can see the differences between that one and the Lionel one.
For the two, I'm confused. There we go. The two light bulbs, little thing, are just the same. This says 45 with an indent. This says Mofakva. But the light bulbs, bracket and whatnot, are the same. I can do that. It might be a while, but I can do that. And the electrical connection, where is it? There's the electrical connection on it. And this had a cable wire that went around all the way around everything. And you didn't put it together right. You didn't play anymore. You were sent to Siberia.
If you didn't play right, you were sent to Siberia.
Yeah. Well, how do you think, what's his name, got there and got himself dead? Whew.
All right. No politics on the TTML.
No politics. Not me.
Yeah, my older Gateman, the wood box has the Lionel name embossed on it and the part number and everything.
I
turn that people, around. Yep, off comes the rough.
I tell people that I think that's the most common thing, except for you had. Look at that. Yeah, it does. You got a chimney?
You can see it all embossed all the way to the inside.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Both of mine have the same window.
That's cool. I can read it now. Oh, well. Yeah, I think I got that at a flea market in Brooklyn.
Mm. Those are available. You know, some of the Russian stuff is really hard. That little guy comes along more frequently than not.
Maybe on the East Coast, but not out here in the West Coast.
Well, we'll send you some.
All right. Does anybody have anything else tonight on the operating cars or operating accessories or anything else that we want to share before I close it out and we'll open it up for open forum?
I've got a question. For
go ahead, Carl.
Operating cars. Did anybody get the Lionel TMCC crane? I would say that's probably the most complex operating car they ever made.
I have two, Carl. I have a Conrail and a Pennsylvania with the sound car.
Oh boy.
And you don't want to lift that boom up without any kind of a load on it, or you're really asking for it. My repairman gets about $150 to restring it.
Oh boy.
Yeah. It's quite. There's I think there's four motors in it.
Mm.
One of the nicest cranes actually is the reissue of the 282 with TMCC. It actually rides on a piece of Special Gargraves five rail track.
Oh, okay. That's the gantry crane that goes over the top of the car.
Right, right. I saw years ago somebody used to take a 175 rocket launcher base and, you know, have it move like at 4 or 5 inches, but it would go back and forth. You didn't really have very good control. But with this, you could have a piece that's 36 inches long and it could traverse the whole thing, because it picks it up through the wheels, just like a two rail train, has a little sure. tiny. And it's, you know, pretty nice. And it works off the TMCC handheld, you know, so there's no wiring, there's two wires and you're done.
Oh, that's so nice.
Yeah. And that other crane that you mentioned, that has six outriggers that pop out and boom that spins around and the boom that goes up and down. And it's really something. But again, I dozed off and I'm glad I would at least get on here. I'm not down in the train room tonight. We're in our mess room. So.
All right. Well, thanks, Bob. I appreciate that. I appreciate the input. Yeah, Clem, I see you waving your digits. Go ahead.
This is the five rail track. Help me.
Up a little higher. There you go.
Rail track. You'll notice it's got if you can see the three in the middle here. Yeah, my fingers are on three of them. That's O gauge. And the O gauge track has its own set of ties, plus it's clipped onto the standard gauge track. You noticed? This is Kurt Ludwig's track, and this subcontractor's good workmanship. We had the dickens of time putting this track together. What we finally ended up with is laying it flat and getting a 2x4 and banging on the ends of it. I tried to put it together here and I'm still bleeding. If I can tell you, how do I show you this? If it falls apart, it's your fault. You see this, let me give you a little pinky finger. Got it? See my pinky finger? Now look down here. There's a difference in that space.
No, it's not cut square.
Well, see, that's tighter than this. I don't know the answer. Kurt says these are not right here to here. Right here to here. It is not a one gauge gap. And I don't know how to respond to that, because I love him dearly. I'm not going to fuss, but I'll have some of this and we'll have a discussion. I'm sure it's me not understanding. The center rail here is power for the whole mess.
Yeah, it looks like
that second rail is bent.
What?
It looks like your second rail is bent upwards at the joint, so it's a little wider gauge.
This guy?
Yeah.
Yeah, it does.
Well, I had trouble getting this on, so it may be me. If I push here, it just hurts my hands. It just hurts.
Yeah, you use a long way from the nearest tie, so it may wobble a bit.
Well, the thing is pretty stiff.
Yeah, it looks like it's just standard gauge and O-gauge track put together sharing the center rail.
Yeah. That's what he said, but other people said, no, this is one gauge and something else. I don't have an answer. I haven't completed my research. I'm lucky to get this far. But it is neat that I can put out this stuff in a small room in a second bedroom and run standard gauge. I can run one gauge. Some of the rollers are a little bit off center and will short things out on some of the engines. But I'm delighted. Thank you very much.
All right. Thank you, Clem. Mm-hmm. Michael, I see you got your hand up.
Yeah. Can you hear me?
Yeah, we hear you fine. Okay. Go ahead.
There's something wrong before. I have an original 282, and I'm not home to show it. I wish I was. But I took it and added TMCC to it. It runs on Gargave Graves' track up and back. Mine runs at about 30 inches up and back. And I added the crane house to it. So it speaks to you just like the crane car and its caboose does.
What did you use for a motor, Michael, to make it go up and down if it's an original 282?
I have a motor mounted under the board. A 6-volt motor, and it goes a little tiny 5-pound fishing line goes across down and under to the motor, so you can hardly see the fishing line that's monofilament that's pulling it up and back.
Nice job.
Oh, so Park the wheels
makes the track.
Right, but the wheels aren't powered.
No, unfortunately, they don't make motors, at least that you can add to an old piece. Right. And in this way, I didn't have to do anything to change the old piece. If it ever wants to go away and be sold, just take the clippers and the connections are gone.
Right. See, I'm on one of the legs, they actually put...
TMCC runs it through relays, so I didn't have to change any of the mechanism of the 282.
Right. See, this one, it's totally different. It's two can motors, and it actually works, believe it or not, with what looks like traction tires for belting.
Yeah, the one you're talking about is the new one.
Right, the new one.
And it's similar to the mechanism on the boom crane.
Exactly. And I had to add a magnet to the superstructure because it's just one wheel that's powered. And it's got this little tiny traction tire. And even on the Gargrave's track, it gets stuck sometimes. But it works. And you also have this sound shack too, right?
Yeah, I have the sound shack. Sound in the work caboose is much better than the sound in the sound shack.
Right.
It doesn't anticipate as well as the other one does.
And dialogue between the ground man and the man in the crane. The shack is just... basically the noise and the sound.
It's just the foreman. That's it.
Right.
Where's the other one? You got it, Sarah. Let's do it.
Right. You got it. That's it. That's it. Exactly. If they ever do this subject again, I'll be better prepared. I'm sure you will too. I like to see that fishing one. That's interesting.
I would too. I just didn't realize it was, and I'm not at home, so I can't run downstairs and hook up.
Right.
And that's one of those things that we would love to see the pictures on the TTML to kind of get people juiced up to come on to see the Zoom, to see it actually in action. That almost sounds like a this for that we've been talking about, how you make something out of something else. because you took something original and you modified it just to make it work. Almost sounds like something they do over the choo-choo bar.
Well, the reason behind it is I had the old crane. They came out with the new crane. And I said, well, why do I have to buy the new one? I got the old one. I'll just make the old one work like the new one.
Good thinking.
Exactly. That's a great idea. All right, Carl, I see you got your hand up. Go ahead.
The fishing line reminded me. I had a Tyco set when I was late teenage, and it had the operating hopper cars. And there was a section of track you could run the hopper car over and dump the plastic coal out and drop it down. So I made a tipple, and you could run the cars up and dump the coal into the tipple, and then you can run the cars back underneath the tipple. And I've made a similar door on the tipple that you could pull the fishing lines, and then the tipple would open up and dump the coal back in the hopper cars.
How did it work, Carl? If I could interrupt you.
Sure.
I have a, you know, besides my postal, I collect, you know, Tyco box sets from 55 to about 67. And, you know, I got probably 50 of those, you know, cars, either being Boston and Maine and Virginia. And I even have a Brox hopper, which is pretty collectible. Did them doors pop open when you hit that track? I never set any of this stuff up. It's all pretty much boxed up stuff.
Okay. There was a special track. It had a box in it that was a wedge. And in the hopper cars had two doors that would swing towards the side of the car. And this wedge would pull them apart and right. Let the coal drop out.
Yeah,
the one drawback yet was the box stuck up so high that you couldn't drive anything with a low belly on it. Like the locomotives wouldn't go over it.
Right.
You always had to back into it.
I actually have that whole accessory. It's in like a Lionel pitcher frame type box, and you know, I never played with it. It's mint. You know, because once you take it apart, you'll never get it back in. And I often wondered if that was, you know, if Christmas morning 1963, when that was first issued, you know, how aggravating that was, you know, if it worked, you know.
It worked pretty nicely. It really did. We made a special layout for a Boy Scout meeting. And we could run the train around up to the top of the tipple, drop the coal off, run it back down to the bottom, back in, and load the car again.
Did you have the culvert unloading station with the bulldozer that it was kind of a pusher, like almost like a bulldozer that shoved the three culverts off? Did you have that?
No, nope, didn't have that. Yeah, that actually I didn't have much of a kid.
Yeah, that actually worked.
With I still have the cars. I have the cars downstairs and a section of track even.
Yeah, I like I said, I never set the stuff up. I just collect it. If we ever do a Tyco night, I could monopolize the whole.
Yeah, the store-bought car that came with my set had a painted frame, but then I bought the kit, one of the cars in kit form, and it just came with the die-cast, raw die-cast. And as a kid, I didn't know enough to paint it, so I just assembled it, you know, filed the burrs off.
Right. And
screwed it together.
All right. Thank you, Chris.
All right, guys. Well, oh, my camera disappeared. There we go. Didn't realize I knocked my camera off into the ceiling. All right. All of a sudden, you guys are visiting the Grand Canyon again. Clem, go ahead.
I'm coming to you. This is the Disney track. It's made out of early rare plastic. It has no metal on it, so therefore, you got to bring your battery with you. It has a nice little connection. It's
show us the way it couples up the connections.
Just lift it up a little bit higher.
Tug pull, wiggle, 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 wiggle.
A little higher.
Wiggle.
Okay. All right. Yep. Yep. Yep.
Yeah. Clips together. Lightweight. It says one end, it says E4. And the other end, of course, says E1. Lightweight. I think I got it. It says made in China. Now, when you take this and put it next to standard gauge, I'll get it up to where you can see it. Put it next to standard gauge. Yeah. Can I get, let me try. I'm sorry. I'm so damn nervous. A little coffee and all that.
You're with friends. It's okay.
Yeah.
Can you see it?
A little higher.
Gotta raise it up or lower your camera. There you go.
Yeah, the upper track is standard. The metal is standard gauge. The black one is Lionel standard gauge. And it's off by a squinch, just about a squinch. When you take the Lionel with standard gauge and put it on LGB track, can you see that?
Higher.
Doesn't want to. Coming up.
There you go.
Doesn't want to do. Off by inch. That's standard versus
what we're calling one
LGB.
Gauge.
That's it.
Oh, thank you. Okay.
And you take, then if I take, just to take stuff with no engineering background, this is 5 rail. Ooh, that's taste. Wait a minute, I hit something and it's gone nuts. What was I doing? I'm doing standard. What was I doing? No, I'm doing something else. Yeah, I'm doing the 5 rail track, and here comes the O gauge. Here comes the O gauge with pins. And I got to go down where I can see because I'm shaking so bad. Just a minute. But I think I'm going to show you something that doesn't quite fit. How's that?
Yeah.
2 out of 3 ain't bad, right? Look at that upper one.
Oh, that's too bad.
1/16 of an inch. I don't know who's wrong or who's right. I have no idea. Just reporting. I know that this works great with standard gauge. Yeah, the inside track works great with gauge one, either one of the versions of gauge one. I'm happy to be alive. Thank you.
All right. Thank you,
Clem. Does flyer work on that?
Pardon?
Does flyer work on that five rail?
Flyer what?
Flyer, S gauge. Or not? Does anyone know?
Not even close. There is a 5 rail that has standard gauge and flyer S gauge.
Mm-hmm.
I've seen that out there in the marketplace. I'm trying to remember. I think it was Gargraves that makes it. Mm-hmm. They make a S gauge and standard gauge, and they make an S gauge and maybe O gauge.
Yeah.
But, if it's oddball, Gargraves ends up making it. But
I'll see. Yeah,
they have an easy system. They can adjust it pretty nicely.
All right. Carl, you got your hand up. We got about five minutes to go. Go ahead.
Okay. One thing I wanted to say was this little hand car I showed you earlier. For some reason, the wheels are HO gauge. It fits on HO track. And they had another series of smaller trains, and they're all N gauge, and they fit on N gauge nicely. And then they had one that you got a whole passenger train inside that little capsule, and it was Z gauge. So, I got a hold of a section of Z gauge track to display that one on. So somebody understands gauge at Ferio Chocolate.
Absolutely fun.
All right. Does anybody have anything else for this evening? I don't see any other hands up or anything. Real quick, we were talking just about 10 minutes ago about having a Tyco night. I don't know how that would be received, but I'm open to all kinds of ideas. We're looking, the reason that we're trying to get the two key people from TCA who were involved in the White House layout together, but our dates are conflicting with events like Allentown. And so they were over in Allentown today and they couldn't make a commitment to being here tonight. But I am trying to work to have the two key people, George Starrs and Stacy from our business office, join us so we can have them for a question and answer period about how the White House Christmas train came about. It's kind of an interesting story. The backstory is really interesting about all the secrecy and what TCA could do and couldn't do because the interior designers had so much to do with the project as well. So a lot of that had to play out in the background. I know we were talking earlier, why not standard gauge, why G gauge and all this? And it was the design team at the White House that had a lot of the call, shall we say, about what engine was going to be used or what gauge was going to be used. Real interesting story. Love to get it out here so we could share it with everybody. But does anybody have a topic that they think would be a general interest for the evening? Going back to flyer, you know, flyer O gauge, pre-war flyer O gauge, or something like that, for a topic to see what would be an interest. We really would like to do layouts again, and have guys try to video or do still photos of their home layouts. Layouts are always popular on the TTML when people share layouts. So that's else that we're looking at.
I could get my crew over and we could televise an operating session.
Chris, as far as that, if you ever want me to do, I have about 130 box sets and I'd say maybe 10 or 15 of them are pretty, they're mint and they're very nice. And, you know, I can set them up on a kitchen table and, you know, do 10 or 15 minutes. But, you know, by 20 minutes, you know, people are going to be, you know, screaming, that's enough, you know, because, you know, it's mostly O-gaugers. But I got some pretty interesting stuff that I collected over the way. I've been doing it about 15 years. And I don't run none of this stuff, but, you know, I got some interesting accessories and, you know, things like that, but mostly sets that are, you know, either like new or mint. So,
you know, that's a good idea, Bob.
If you ever want to do that, just throw the idea out there that, you know, right before we do the, you know, I need like a day or two. And I would also need my wife to hold the camera while I, you know, and she'd be more than happy to, you know, to help. And, you know, like I said, but, you know, 15 or 20 minutes, it, you know, be more than enough, you know, because we'll be down to three people watching, I think.
Well, that's it. That's the hard thing about it, because trying to do any one topic from any one individual seems to overload the system. But when we get to move things around from different people, set boxes is a good idea. I hadn't thought about that one. Carl, go ahead.
Oh, I'd be interested in doing layout construction and layout wiring. You know, I've got that PVC terminal strip thing I could do. Makes the wiring really easy.
Sure. Are you going to be crawling underneath the layout to show it?
I can walk under my layout. Standing up.
All right. The layouts that I run on, we're on creepers. Go ahead, Clint.
Chris, another thought would be maybe to show unusual buildings that we have. You know, some, you go to train shows and you see a lot of scratch built stuff, and and then the old cardboard European buildings, you know, and stuff. That might be fun. It's not trains per se, but in the area of scenery and buildings, unusual things.
Okay. Yeah, there was an interesting thing on social media right before Christmas for the G-Gagers, and it was shared on the Toy Train forums. But the those metal buildings that show up right before Christmas time, people were snatching those things up and repainting them and putting them outdoors for their G-Gage layout. They were just, you know, you could buy those things 3 for $10, and they were just repainting them because they're typically just one color. But that's a great idea, John. You know, I'm writing all this stuff down because I'm running out of ideas for things for us to talk about on Sunday evening. So with that, go ahead. Go ahead, Carl.
Okay, well, I like to kitbash Plasticville buildings into things that fit my layout better.
All right. Well, we got several good topics going forward. And on behalf of Joseph and Carl and Stu, who's still driving home from Allentown, we want to thank everybody for joining us this evening. I'm going...